right, thanks. That was great. I spent $300 on a panophthalmoscope, and now he says he doesn't care about anything. So, when I was in residency, there was a trauma attending who was teaching the surgery interns about managing the trauma, and he said, if you have a trauma patient, don't ever, ever look in the eyes with an ophthalmoscope. The surgery intern said, why? The trauma attending said, because you might drop it and hit them in the eye. So I'm sure you don't count on the surgery interns to ever call you with anything. So. All right, so let's talk about some more killer EKGs. And this is the lecture where I guess I say, you know, my career largely is about serving as a warning to other people. So I'm going to share some of the mistakes that I've made and I've seen as we go through this. Case number one, I did not see this patient, but this did happen in a hospital I was working with, and one of my colleagues was involved in this. This is a 66-year-old woman, history of breast cancer and diabetes, came in complaining of a few days of mesenteral chest pain, which was sharp, no radiation. She's got mild dyspnea on exertion, no nausea. The reason she came in today is because today she developed some chest heaviness with dyspnea at rest now and diaphoresis. So there's a few really, really bad words in there. Diaphoresis for one, dyspnea at rest and heaviness, never like hearing that. Exam, she's, the vital signs are pretty typical for somebody who looks sick in the emergency department. Afebrile, she's a bit tachypneic, tachycardic. Pulse ox is okay, finger stick's okay, blood pressure's okay, lungs, cardiac, pulses. There's nothing really diagnostic on the exam. So we get a quick 12 lead EKG, and I think you can even see the computer interpretation up there. There's ST segment elevation in the inferior leads and a little bit in the anterolateral leads. And so, by the way, if you have a STEMI that involves inferior and anterolateral, that usually is a wraparound LAD. So that's a big MI, and this is an older patient who is having some concerning symptoms. The computer's calling it, so they call cardiology. Cardiology comes down, says it's an infra anterolateral STEMI. We gotta get the patient up to the cath lab, so let's give him some aspirin, and let's give him clopidogrel or ticagrelor, and if you want, you can probably throw in some G2B3 inhibitors. We're gonna kill the platelets. Get the patient up to the cath lab. They squirt the dye, and it's a clean cath. But in the cath lab, the patient develops a hemorrhagic tamponade and died on the cath lab table. Then cardiology looks back at this 12 lead EKG and says, oh my God, I can't believe we missed this. What's the diagnosis? Well, if you look, I'm hearing some people say it, if you look, diffuse ST segment elevation, one of the things you've got to think about is pericarditis, but there's something more here. There's also evidence here of a pericardial effusion, this combination of low voltage and tachycardia. She had breast cancer. What do you think the cause of her pericardial effusion is? It's a MET to the pericardium, and what did we just give her? Aspirin and clopidogrel and heparin, and we just turned that into a hemorrhagic tamponade, and that was the cause of death. So we're going to talk about what the computer missed, what the emergency physicians missed, and what the cardiologist missed in this particular case. We're going to talk about pericardial effusions because this is an increasingly common cause of chest pain and especially shortness of breath. And if you take one pearl from this lecture, actually I'll be a little disappointed, but if you only take one pearl from this lecture, every time you see somebody with shortness of breath, please keep in mind pericardial effusion in your differential. All right, I think everybody's great at thinking about, could this be a PE, could this be ACS? Please remember, pericardial effusion has to be consideration because we're seeing more and more pericardial effusions in our first world population than ever before because of dialysis patients, renal patients, cancer patients, patients that are getting chemo. These are all causes of pericardial effusion, and they typically present with a whole bunch of other cardiac risk factors, and they present short of breath, and they look and sound just like PEs or just like ACS. What do you do for PEs and ACS? You anticoagulate them. What happens if they actually had a pericardial effusion and you just anticoagulated them? Exactly what you saw here. You turn them into a hemorrhagic tamponade. So you've got to know the key point here in making the distinction. Now, this is a classic teaching that we all learn about pericardial effusion. Electrical alternans, tachycardia, low voltage, cardiomegaly. There's some problems here. Electrical alternans, first of all, is pretty much always present on the boards and in the textbooks, but in real life, only about a third of your patients with large effusions will have electrical alternans, so you can't rely on it. right? Tachycardia. Well, if your patient's on beta blockers and calcium channel blockers, it may be blunted cardiomegaly. It's a little bit limited because all of these patients are sick. Now, I'm not talking about little sliver-sized pericardial fusions. I'm talking about big ones that make people sick. Almost always these patients have cardiomegaly, but sick patients usually get portable chest x-rays, and what does that mean? Everybody's got a big heart. So the x-ray is not all that useful. What I'm gonna ask you to do, and here's the second take-home point from this entire lecture, please remember this simple combination. Anytime you see tachycardia plus low voltage on a 12-lead EKG, in your mind think, this is an effusion until proven otherwise. All right, I'll say that again. Every time you see on the EKG tachycardia with low voltage, that's a pericardial effusion until proven otherwise. It's a simple pearl that will save lives, and it'll save your butt in many cases also. Now, how do we define low voltage? You don't have to remember this slide. This is the specific definition. This is the cardiologist's definition. I'm gonna tell you something a little bit more simple that I learned, because what we're interested in the emergency department is not specificity, but sensitivity. We wanna not miss things, all right? So the specific definition you'll read in the textbooks and cardiologists, they talk about, you wanna see in the limb leads, all of the QRS complexes have amplitudes less than 5, or in the precordial leads, all the QRSs have amplitudes less than 10. So they're all relatively small, but they all have to be under 5 in limb leads, under 10 in the precordial leads, one or the other. That's what you see as the formal definition in the textbooks. What I'm gonna suggest is something more simple. This is the sensitive definition. Take the QRS amplitude and lead 1, 2, and 3, add them up. If it's less than 15, call it low voltage. Or take the QRS amplitude and V1, V2, V3, add them up. If it's less than 30, call it low voltage, either one. And I'll show you examples of this as we go through this, all right? So here's the specific definition. This is what the cardiologists typically use, all right? Look at the QRS complex amplitudes in all of the limb leads. They all have to be 5 or less. If you look at this example, lead 2 is just maybe a little bit too high to meet the specific definition here. But the cardiologists are gonna want all of those QRS complexes to be less than 5 millimeters. If they are, they'll call it low voltage. Or in the precordial leads, all of the QRS complexes less than 10 millimeters. That would meet their definition for low voltage. That's the specific definition. The definition that I learned from the cardiologist that really inspired me to learn about electrocardiography was more simple and it's much more sensitive. What he said was, take the QRS complex amplitudes in 1 plus 2 plus 3, and if you add them up and it's less than 15, it's low voltage. Or V1 plus V2 plus V3, if that adds up to less than 30, then call it low voltage. If you use this definition, you're gonna pick up more cases. It's a little bit less specific, but you're gonna pick up more cases, all right? So that's what I use. 1 plus 2 plus 3 less than 15, V1 plus 2 plus V2 plus V3 less than 30, that's low voltage. Now, what's your differential for low voltage? Here's the simple way I think of it. I think of the heart as a battery putting current out to the chest leads. These leads are picking up how much current they're getting. Well, if there's something blocking the current getting out to the leads, that's gonna give you low voltage. What kind of things can block the current getting out to the leads? Well, if there's fluid, pericardial fluid or pleural fluid, then you're gonna get less voltage picked up by the leads. If there's a lot of fat, obesity, which is probably the most common cause that we'll see, or if there's a lot of air, barrel chest from COPD. These are the often causes of low voltage on the 12 lead. The other thing that can produce low voltage is if the battery is simply weak. What are the things that give you a weak battery? Well, myxedema or severe hypothyroidism gives you a weak battery. End-stage cardiomyopathies can give you low voltage, a weak battery. Or infiltrative diseases, cardiac amyloid, cardiac sarcoid, things like that, that'll give you low voltage also. So here's your differential for what produces low voltage. But for us in the emergency department, we're oftentimes concerned with why is this patient having new low voltage? In this entire list up here, what are the things that give you new low voltage compared to last month? People don't get obese within a month, typically. People don't develop COPD within a month or develop infiltrated diseases. The two things up here that will give you new low voltage compared to EKG done last month, for example, are pericardial effusion and pleural effusion. So in emergency medicine, if you see low voltage plus tachycardia, especially if the low voltage is new, there's only two things to think about: pericardial fluid and pleural fluid. And it's really easy to rule out pleural effusion, just get a chest x-ray. And it's pretty easy to rule out pericardial fluid, just do your bedside echo, all right? And I'll tell you up front, a lot of you know this, I'm not very good at bedside echo. But even I, with simple skills, can pick up a large pericardial effusion. And again, we're not talking about little sliver effusions, we're talking about large effusions. Going back to this case, this was the baseline EKG, and when the patient showed up, take a look what happened to the voltage, take a look, here's the new EKG. You see it dropped. Tachycardia plus new low voltage, this was a pericardial effusion until proven otherwise. This patient should have just gotten a quick POCUS to rule out effusion before being sent up to the cath lab. Unfortunately, that wasn't done. A couple other cases here. This was sent by Mark Sarto, who works over at McGill. 51-year-old with increasing shortness of breath. Again, pearl number one. Anybody with shortness of breath, you've got to think about pericardial effusion. And actually, this patient on the monitor has very nice electrical alternans, and on the 12 lead, if you look at the rhythm strip at the bottom, you see a very nice alternans. You can't always rely on alternans. Less than a third of patients will have alternans, but you'll also notice he's got low voltage with borderline tachycardia. This patient ended up having a pericardial window after he was diagnosed with lung cancer with mets to the pericardium. Here's another case from BC, actually, 42-year-old male with shortness of breath. Pearl number one, anybody with shortness of breath, you've got to consider pericardial effusion. Get a 12 lead, and what you notice there, there's low voltage and tachycardia. And if you look at that rhythm strip at the bottom, you'll also appreciate alternans. So this patient has all three. You're often not that lucky. This was my case I'll share with you. 50-some-year-old woman came in, history of breast cancer with chest pressure, shortness of breath. Cancer, chest pressure, shortness of breath, what's the diagnosis? PE, right. So I stood there with the resident and said, you know what, this is a PE. We should probably get a coronary or a CTPA, but CT was pretty backed up. So I said, you know what, we gotta wait 2 hours for the CAT scan, let's not risk it. Let's just start the heparin now. So he started heparin. 2 hours later, the patient finally goes over to CAT scan. And then we get that call from CAT scan. We need a doctor in CAT scan right away. So that's never good. Pearl three, right? Just once in my career, I want to go running over to CAT scan and say, Dr. Mattu, just want to thank you for ordering the CAT scan. No. So the patient's now dripping sweat, hypotensive, looks awful. We bring her back to the ED and we repeat the CAT scan. Now, I missed this. Take a look, she's already got tachycardia and low voltage, right? Add up the QRS complexes in 1, 2, and 3, it's less than 15. Or if you add the QRS complexes in V1, V2, V3, it's less than 30. She's got both. She's got tachycardia and low voltage. I missed it because I was thinking so much about PE. We brought the patient back from CAT scan looking awful and repeated the CAT scan. Take a look at what happened. The voltage drops even more. And now, look up there in V1, V2, now alternans is present. And so now the diagnosis is clear. So we had to quickly reverse with protamine and call CT surgery, and she went up to CT surgery to have a large hemorrhagic effusion drained out. We nearly killed her. And then the last case I'll share with you, this is a 30-some-year-old guy who came in HIV positive. He's also an injection drug user. And he came in with a fever of 102, fever about 39 or so Celsius, and just not looking well. That's a piece of cake. It's a rule out endocarditis. So what do you do with endocarditis? You send off 13 sets of blood cultures, admit them to medicine, right? And then they can start the antibiotics upstairs. Piece of cake. So that's what we did. We got a whole bunch of blood cultures, and this is an injection drug user with a fever. No doubt. Just rule out endocarditis. Get ready to go up to medicine. Well, medicine comes down and says, well, we want our admission EKG, right? What a waste of time. But we got the admission EKG, and take a look at those limb leads. There's low voltage and tachycardia. So what's our rule? Low voltage and tachycardia, that's an effusion until proven otherwise. So we just did a quick bedside echo on him, and he's got a huge MRSA pericardial effusion, all right? What would have happened if we just sent him upstairs to rule out endocarditis? He would have slowly developed hypotension and probably died. So thankfully, we ended up following that rule, low voltage plus tachycardia. So finishing up, quick take-home points. Please remember, low voltage plus tachycardia equals pericardial effusion until proven otherwise. How do you prove otherwise? Just get your echo and take a look. It's a simple diagnosis, especially if that low voltage is new. And stay away from any anticoagulants or antiplatelet agents until you've done that quick bedside echo. Otherwise, you just might cause an iatrogenic death, all right? And alternans, don't rely on alternans. It's classic. And what does classic mean in Latin? 15%. I'm just joking. But anything in medicine that's ever been said to be classic ends up being about 15%, so don't rely on it, all right? Okay, thanks a lot.